good afternoon. As it is your last lecture, we'll have some small farewell for you. So let's begin with the felicitation part. May I call Miss Renuka? Please present the moment. We will like you to open it, sir. So there's another gift for you. I would like Faizan to please present. And it's also personalized frame for you. Sir, as we have a positive of time, so we'll wrap this up quickly. Just a few questions to ask you, sir. So the first one is, sir, I think this is a common question from all of us. Why did you always ask us, should I make you write this or put it on the board? Even if you know that we would prefer the latter.
Some students prefer writing, they get the, I don't know, they get the satisfaction that there is something written on the registers. So I usually ask the students, if they choose not to, then I put it on their portrait. That's this. Only it's better.
So the next question is, sir, you gave us many case studies to teach and explain ethics. Please tell us one such case study which happened in your original life and where you and where you were also glad to apply the ethics part and you were satisfied with the application.
That is a very difficult question. I think many things happen. Many of these case studies are borrowed, not from something that I've read, because most of what I've read is very fake, is very artificial. Many of the incidents that I brought you over here are incidents that students have come and shared with me. They tell me something or the other. There was this one case where a boy had told me, I don't know which class we're looking at, where the boy had told me that he was offered a bribe for a couple of months, he was harassed, he was victimized. Those kind of things happen. And when students come, you know, interacting with you teaches the teacher far more than anything that we learn from the books. So a lot we learn from there.
So the next question is, can you explain the mantra what
Ravindran
sir gave you all teachers for
to maintain the Vajiram's work culture? I don't think they told us anything at all. Nobody says anything to anyone in Vajiram, but in Vajiram the culture has been created, I think, by Mr. Ravindran. With you people, I think he's taken one class with you, and I think he would have been far luckier had he taken a few more classes with you. He's one person, you know, when you come to Vajiram, as a student or as a teacher, he's the person who sets the benchmark. He's the person who takes the classes. He's the person who works, I think, must be about 65, 67 years old. But he's the one person who works harder than all of us. When you people reach your interview, this is why I tell you, when you reach the interview, whichever part of India you're from, whatever you've done in your college, whatever your background is, you must spend at least 10 to 15 minutes alone with him. It's very difficult to find time with him because he's usually very busy. But he's one person who can really make a huge difference in your preparation, especially for the interview. So I think we look up to him. Whatever he does, to a large extent, we try to follow that. And that is very comfortable.
Thank you. Any other questions from the audience side?
Sir, now you are teaching ethics, and you are so disciplined and well trimmed and all things. What is the naughtiest thing you did in your teaching?
Bruce, I will not tell you. every single person has certain problems, has certain flaws, has certain shortcomings. All of us have faults, which includes you as well as me. My faults I'm not going to tell you over here at all. But I will tell you that over a certain period of time, you start learning a little more discipline. When you have empty time, you do a lot of things that you should not be doing. As you start getting a little busier, everything else falls into the background. That question I will not answer very clearly.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we are in the few last months of the prelims preparation. So everyone is feeling the pressure. Just we want you to relieve some of us of pressure with your emotional message or motivation.
Yes, he's absolutely right in saying that a lot of students are experiencing a lot of pressure, a lot of stress. First point for you, please do not worry. Whatever happens, this is just an examination, just one attempt. I assure you another 3 or 5 years down the line, you will not even remember what this exam was about. Every now and then you will remember the classes that you had here, you will remember the friends that you made, you will remember the times that you had, but you will not remember this exam. What I will ask you to do is, and I don't want any one of you to give up without at least trying sincerely once. Today is the 31st of March, you have exactly 2 months after this. I expect your next 25 days are going to be very difficult. They're going to give you double classes, they really want to pace it up, you will not have too much time. But just go through that time. After that, sit and focus on the prelims. See, when you're sitting for this examination, the biggest problem is that there are a lot of people who will give you advice. There will be teachers, there will be friends, there will be people on the internet, there will be people who have cleared the examination. Please start learning how to listen, but not necessarily agree with what people are saying. There are many students, in fact, I usually don't name anyone, but there are many teachers who will tell you that you have to read so-and-so book, you have to read so-and-so magazine, you have to read so-and-so newspaper, visit these websites, make your notes in this manner. Whatever I tell you is based on my experiences, it is not necessarily who you are. When I was preparing for the exam, I cannot study at night. At night, after about 9, 9:30, my brain just doesn't work. At that time, all that I can do is read a book for pleasure, I can watch some TV, talk to a friend. Beyond that, I can't do anything. But there are some people who can sit down at 10 o'clock at night and study till 4 in the morning. Every single person is different. There is one person who is very good at maths. There is another person who is very good at history. There is another person who is very good at science. Whoever you are, whatever suits you, please learn how to identify that. All of you are very young. You know, there are people who are 20, 21, 19, 23 years old. You haven't still found out what you are about. Identify that. Identify whether or not you are good for this examination, whether this exam or this career is good for you. Sit down, study, learn. If I look at the time, you people must have joined in August. In the last 7 or 8 months, can I say there's been a significant difference in the way that you saw the world then and how you see the world now? That same difference you'll see now when you go back home or wherever, if you belong to Delhi, wherever you go back, when you sit down and you study for a couple of months, you realize a very different side of yourself. At that point in time, earlier, you know, when you're in school or you're in college, when you get bored, you seek distractions. I know that I have to sit down and study for 3 days or 3 hours because my exam is coming up. But after 1.5 hours, my concentration breaks. Those of you who are serious about this examination, who have the passion, will be able to find that time no matter what. A lot of students come and meet me and they talk about problems. But you know, so I saw an old lady near the metro station, she doesn't even have food to eat. Someone will come and tell me that, sir, next to our house, there is a married couple. The husband, I think, is ill-treating the wife. What can I do? See, in all these questions, any problem that you're facing, whether a social problem, an economic problem, national problem, studies, anything, if you are passionate about it, you will never ask questions, you will find the solution. And for something, if you do not try to find the solution, if it is only a doubt in your mind, then invariably you are not very passionate about it. And if you're not passionate, you will not be able to stick to it. Identify what exactly. See, if I was looking at your parents' generation, they did not have too many opportunities. At that time, career opportunities were very limited. Mobility, whether geographical or occupational, was very limited. Today, whether you're a girl or you're a boy, whether you're a lower caste or an upper caste, a Hindu or a Muslim, a South Indian, North Indian, you can go wherever you want in this country. The entire country with all its opportunities is available to you. Do not make the mistake of sitting or, you know, fixating on only one career option or only one alternative. Explore the world. The best opportunity for that in this entire country is a city called Delhi. If I can be there, 2 or 3 cities which are comparable with Delhi, but this is the absolute best because Delhi gives you a mixture of the private sector as well as the government. Look around you, try to identify what you are actually interested in. It could be anything. This is one girl in the basement over here, 2 or 3 years back. She gave the exam twice, gave the mains twice, but neither times did she clear the mains. After a second interview, when she did not clear the mains, I remember, I think this is 2017 I'm talking about, she came and met me and she said that, sir, 2 mains I've given, but I just cannot improve my marks. I said, what is the problem? She said, sir, I don't feel like studying. She said, I enjoy whatever I've studied, I really enjoy it. I've learned a lot, but I really don't feel like studying it anymore. So I said, what do you want to do? She said, very honestly, I want to work in an international organization. I thought this was a very good platform. I would get into the foreign services and so on. After that, this girl sat for, I don't know, there's this one, what is that called? The UN Civil Service. She sat for that examination, cleared the examination very comfortably because this exam is very tough. You're prepared for everything else. Cleared that examination, currently she's posted in Delhi, has an excellent career and a very content life, personally and professionally. So this is not the end of it. You haven't even explored 1/10 of the options that are available to you. Whoever you are, whatever you're doing, whatever your capabilities, again I'm repeating, there are a lot of students going through tremendous amounts of stress. Please do not subject yourself to that. Focus on whatever you can do. Identify your capabilities. Most importantly, identify what is your passion. What exactly do you want to do? And whatever it may be, this is one student of mine, got into the IAS, served for 3 years. After 3 years, resigned. And currently, what is he doing? He was from the state of UP. He had played Ranji for UP under 19s. And now he's joined with three different IPL teams, managing, I don't know, their finances or managing their administration. And is extremely happy after resigning from the IAS. Because he says, sir, a government job is just not meant for me. I want to travel, I want to be associated with cricket and so on. Whoever you are, whatever you're doing, I really hope that you clear the examination. But even if you feel at any point in time that you don't want to do this, don't lie to yourself. Be honest, identify something that you'll enjoy doing and you'll never have to work for a day in your life. That is what I would ask you to do.
Thank you, sir. So, just one last question. What's your hometown and how can we contact you after the classes get over?
My hometown is Shimla, which is the capital of Himachal Pradesh. I really don't identify with any part of India because my father was in the army. He was transferred rather than traveled along with me. I think I've stayed in which all states? I've stayed in Jammu and Kashmir, I've stayed in Himachal, I've stayed in Punjab, I've stayed in Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Rajasthan, Odisha, West Bengal, Assam. For a little while we were in Jharkhand, we were in Bihar, we were in Madhya Pradesh. That's almost, yes, I think I've about 7 or 8 states I've not been to, the other states I've lived in. So, but my home state is Himachal, city Shimla. If you want to contact me today or any point of time in the future, this is my mail ID, bsingh.ethics@gmail.com. Yes, ethics has to be there, @gmail.com.
Is it really changing the personality or behavior of the civil servant? If it is, how many percentage it is changing now?
Ethics is a part of the civil services examination. Is it changing anyone's behavior? Is it actually bringing out a change in the bureaucracy? If I want to answer the question, I don't have any empirical evidence. I don't have any data where I can give you substantive answers. But yes, I can tell you, given my experiences inside the classrooms, if I compare you people with the students who are starting just 5 or 6 years back when the paper was started in 2013, at that time, when I used to sit for the interviews, when students came, you know, you begin by asking them personal questions. Tell me something about yourself, introduce yourself, why do you want to join the bureaucracy? These students would give what I would say were very hollow answers. I want to serve the country, I want to serve the people, but they did not really believe that. These days, you know, the first time you meet someone, if he comes and asks me that I want help for the interview, I will never say anything to him. I will first tell him, sit down, I'm going to ask you 3 or 4 questions, then I will look at your DEF. Because first, I have to understand his true inclinations. Now when I do this with these students, when I ask them, why do you want to join? Usually they don't say, I want to serve the country. They don't say, I want a career in the bureaucracy. They start by sharing something or the other that happened in their lives, which genuinely motivate. I make fun of you inside the classes, that you people want a comfortable life, you want a safe life. This is not that career. But these people, when you meet them face to face during the interview, they genuinely, with a lot of conviction, some of them, you know, they've gone through very difficult times. And you can see it in their eyes that they can remember those times and they genuinely have a passion to bring that about. Problem, however, this is what happens when you're here. Problem, however, is in which I feel maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong. During the training phase, a lot of these tendencies are immediately done away with. The sense that the ethics paper was introduced by the UPSC, but in the training academies, similar changes are broadly brought about. So by the time these people finish their training, many of them revert to who they were before the exam process started. But the fact that it is bringing about changes is illustrated by the fact that now even for the Indian engineering services, an ethics segment has been introduced. And the government is proposing that it should be added more and more. I cannot, what I told in the first class, by teaching you in 10, 12, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50 classes, I cannot make you people ethical, I cannot make you people honest, but yes, I can certainly instill in you a distinction between what is right and what is wrong, encourage you, facilitate you to try and do what is right, and when you knowingly do something wrong, at least for the next few months or the next couple of years, you will certainly feel guilty about knowingly doing something wrong. That is where the changes come from. So hopefully it will have an impact.
I just wanted to say something to you, sir. A lot of people here say that when you give a notion like start dictating and stop somewhere and say that we'll be given the material, I would always request you to give the time for us because your thoughts are supersonic speed, believe me. It's tough to give answers to door ki baat hai, mujhe question tak samajh nahi aati kabhi kabhi. Like case studies, we get it on the slide, of course, yes, you do give it on the portal. Believe me, I have gone through all your slides before the class, at least for 15 minutes, and class seems different because most of it are case studies, and it depends on the person who is explaining the case study rather than just going through the case study. And when you explain the case study, it's like my own life. I saw it in a different way, and you're showing it in a different way. And I need time to think, basically. Time. Woh nahi hota. And the worst part is, next slide, that's not even in the next slide, it's in the back, like, niche of the slide, it's like questions. And you shoot it in supersonic speed. Thoughts bhi us speed mein nahi hoti. So, answers nahi ho paega. So, it's like giving us a small gap so that, as you said in the first class, I think, this 1.5 lakh I pay, not for this video, not for this audio, not for the material, but for the time that you give for interaction. I have a time of 2.5 hours to see you face to face and ask you questions wherever we feel like stuck up. So that 1 minute gap is necessary. Elixir of your class. So please do give that time. And that's just a request from our side because I know you try to cover up the maths. But yeah, we will try to write the replies as comprehensively as you take the class. Thank you so much, sir.
That is something that my mother says to me. She says, you talk too fast. You go too fast. You are way too fast. I started reading Urdu poetry in between and I was very excited. That was the time I was studying for my exams. And I would go, every time I would take a break, I would go and sit with her and I would recite something or the other. She knows a lot of that. She says, you remember everything, but you say it so quickly that I can't even understand what you said. But one thing, so I slow down. Definitely. It's like I slow down.
Thank you.
Something you want to say?
You have actually partially answered my question because I do understand there is a difference between a skill and a talent. But my next question was, how did you develop that way of, you know, thinking fast and, you know, moving fast, and your questions are at supersonic speed? You know what? Believe me, sir, we have two sides of yours which want you to sit in my interview board. And the other part of you, which we don't want to see in the interview board. Because we want you in the interview board, that's because even if you are one person who have given that impression that even if you don't answer all the questions in the interview board, even if you fail to answer most of the questions in the interview board, it's not about answering it rightly, it's about putting what you are bluntly to them. Because it's not about selecting kitna question correct kya, kitna question wrong kya. It's about understanding the person who's sitting before you in the chair. You do have that eye of, you know, looking at the person and knowing what is he thinking behind the brains. So that one part we wanted in the interview board because most of us who are sitting here, it's not bad. They are all good people. So I do recognize that most of us are good people because we all are hardworking to some extent. Most of us come from middle class families, gone through same hurdles, seen a few problems, except the persons of civil servants' families. Because unko to papa mamme civil servant hai to sab pata hai. Aaye kyun hai? So exactly, bahut paisa hai. You're right. So most of us are good, but yes, we are not that good that they expect us to be. So we don't want that part of that in interview board. Ki wo question shoot te jaye aur mere confidence kam hote jaye aur main pata nahi kahan pahunch jaungi. So that part I wanted to ask: is there any way that we can develop it as a skill rather than you got it as a talent?
Very happy over there. He's so happy, he's clapping with someone else's hand. The other day I'm taking a class over some other batch. I gave a boy, I pointed to him, so I said, you raise your hand and then you answer the question. This one boy, I said, raise your hand, he raises thumb. How lazy can you be? And this boy is so happy taking his hand. How do you think fast? How do you speak fast? I really don't know. I speak very quickly because I have a lot to cover in the 2.5 hours that I have with you. Thinking, I think, comes, when you're talking to someone, always try to anticipate what they're saying. That's what I do. When a student, raises their hand, I know that a student is going to ask me a question there. When I look at that person, to some extent, you try to understand what exactly this kind of person is, what is he likely to ask. When you're sitting in interviews, one person will be sitting absolutely quietly. And every now and then they'll smile at you. And when they smile at you, you feel very reassured that this is a decent person, he's going to treat you very well. Unfortunately, they turn out to be the worst of them. They will sit for 10, 20, 15 minutes looking at you, analyzing you, listening to your answers. Then they will ask you the one question that you never dreamt would be asked. So that is how you develop that over a period of time. It will come with time, nothing else.
Thank you.
So much, sir. Gratitude is a way of thanking the person who has spent his time and efforts and beyond all his means to spend us and serve us and teach us a lot. Teachers are the best part because you remember them forever. Good teachers are hard to find, difficult to part with, but impossible to forget. So you have made a great impression with us and thank you so much for that. We end this with you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all of you. And really, there's no need to do so much if you really want all the way. Thank you very much for all the effort that you put in. You had to take the test before this.
Yes.
You have a class after this also.
Yes.
Thank God. That would be very guilty if you had a class after this also. All right.